I'll pull this thing over. I'll read it and y'all be able to see it. So, on Sunday mornings, we're talking about false doctrine. And of course, in false teachers. False teachers deny Christ. Now the word, whenever the Bible speaks of Antichrist and when the Bible speaks of deny, we don't know what that means. 1 John 2:22 says that he that denieth Christ is Antichrist. Of course, the word deny, I'm going to put it up here in the corner. The word deny is A-R-N-E-O-M-A-I. That is the word in the Greek text. We're talking about the original Greek text. We do have the Greek text. It is, for those of you, I notice we've got several new people here. For those of you that are not familiar, this is the original text. It's called an interlinear Bible. My dog Cricket was studying it one day, and I had to tape it up. This has the original Hebrew in the Old Testament, and of course it has the letters below it. And of course, the Hebrew reads from right to left, so you have to read this direction. It has the English under it. And then in the New Testament, that was written in the Greek. And whenever I say Greek, that's what the original text is. And whenever I bring these words up, we're talking about the original text and what it actually means. We don't know what words mean anymore. So whenever I'm saying this word deny, I'm getting it out of the original text. That word deny means to contradict. Deny Christ does not mean to say he didn't live, he didn't exist, and he wasn't God. It just means to say, I believe in Jesus, I believe in God, and I believe he died for sinners, but I don't believe I have to do what he says. That is Antichrist. The word, of course, the word anti is the word anti in the Greek language. It's the same word as our word anti. It means in opposition to. Opposition to, or instead of. So when people contradict the Word of God and they say God doesn't mean what He says, whenever He said in 2 Timothy 3:12, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Whenever Paul said unto you, it is given in the behalf of Christ not only to believe upon Him, but also to suffer for His sake, that we have to suffer for the cause of Christ. When Jesus said in the world you shall have tribulation, when people say that doesn't mean, Jesus doesn't mean that because we live in a Christian nation. This is no more Christian than some pagan country. This is a Babylonian system. If you called yourself a Christian in the first century, then you had to die for it. So whenever men deny Christ, they are antichrist. When they contradict His word, you can say He died to save sinners. You can say that He died on a cross. You can say that He was born of a virgin. Do you know that Roman Catholicism says He was born of a virgin? Do you know that Roman Catholicism says that He was born in Bethlehem and that He came and died on a cross and He died to save sinners? But we don't know what the word believe means. We don't have any idea what words mean anymore. I've been talking about what pure religion is, and it is not the Christ Mass. And we just come out of the Christ Mass season. And you say, Jim, why do you say Christ Mass? That's the meaning of the word. Christ Mass is the word, C-H-R-I-S-T-E-S, C-H-R-I-S-T-E-S-M-A-E-S-S-E. Christ Mass means the festival, does not mean the festival of Christ. It means the Mass of Christ. Mass is eating human flesh. When Constantine brought this into the church in 324 A.D., he brought the Mass into the church. He brought that in out of the ancient fire worship world. He did not reach back to the birth of Christ. He reached back to the fire worship or to Baal worship or Hercules worship. Baal was just a generic term in Israel for Hercules or Adonis. The tree goddess was just another word for Venus. She was called the grove in Israel. And when Ahab married Jezebel, queen of the queen daughter of the king of Tyre, or Ethbaal. Ethbaal was her father. He was a priest of Baal. He was a priest of the Ashtaroth. She brought that system into Israel and called it the worship of Baal in the groves. It is the Mass. That's what it is. It's eating human flesh. Now, I'm talking about false doctrine. I'm talking about what pure religion is. We're talking about these preachers that refuse to tell the truth. We have been lied to about Christmas. We have been lied to. Most people don't know that it was against the law to celebrate Christmas 300 years ago in America. Christmas did not become an American holiday till 1856. Our Protestant ancestors in America 150 years ago had nothing to do with it. It is Roman Catholicism. It's what it is. I like what, there's a famous quote by Voltaire, the famous, the infamous French atheist. He said, what is history? He said, it is the lie that everyone agrees upon. That is history. The lie that everyone agrees upon, even though he was an atheist, he sure got that right, didn't he?
Any popular opinion?
Yeah, it is popular opinion. Let me just give you a couple of figures that I had just a couple of years ago during the Christ Mass season. In 1997, there were 33 million trees in America sold at $3 to $5 a foot. Now, how many poor people could that feed? In 1996, there were 31 million. There were many more than that in 98 and 99. If the average tree is 6 feet tall at $4 a foot, that would be $792 million on those gods that they hang up in their living room, and I have been guilty of that too, and it is a god. It's the old tree worship of the Babylonian system. I've written something up on the board, and I'd like to read it to you. Pure religion. We're talking about James 1:27. Pure religion. Pure religion. Don't tell people you don't believe in religion. The word religion is the word threskia, T-H-R-E-S-K-E-I-A, threskia. Pure is the word katharos. Katharos, we get our word cauterized from that. Whenever you're going to purify a wound, you see the old Western movie and the guy gets shot and the guy digs the bullet out and then he goes there over there to the fire and he heats it up and then he takes and he digs the bullet out and then he sears it over, makes the knife hot and he sears it over and he cauterizes the wound. But pure religion, pure or katharos, threskia is the word ritual. There's only one pure religion, and that is to visit the fatherless and the widow in their affliction and keep yourself unspotted from the world. We said last week that the word fatherless is the word orphanos. We get our word orphan from that, O-R-P-H-A-N-O-S. That's the same word that John used in John the 14th chapter when he said, I'll not leave you comfortless. I'll send the comforter to you. I'll send the word of God. So when you visit the fatherless, you visit the orphans, those who do not have the word of God that are the elect of God, and the widows. The word widow is C-H-E-I-R-A, Kira, Kira, and that means one without a husband. The husband of the church is Christ, and he is gone. He will come back. We visit the church in their affliction, and the word affliction is T-H-L-I-P-S-I-S. That is the word tribulation that Paul used when he said we must through much tribulation enter the kingdom of God in Acts 14:22. Well, that word comes from the word T-H-L-I-B-O. That is the word narrow over there in the 7th chapter of Matthew, verse 14. The narrow way is the tribulation way. Well, the church today doesn't talk about a narrow way. You say, Jim, I hear people saying this or that. I don't hear people talking about a daily cross. I don't hear them talking about suffering for Christ. I don't hear people talking about having to deny self. I don't hear Luke 9:23. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself. Don't deny Christ. Utterly contradict yourself. I don't hear that. I don't know who does hear it, but I don't. Pure religion. When you said baptized from 300 BCE, now that's before the Christian era. That's a word that shows that before the birth of Christ, a CE means the Christian era. That means from the time of Christ on. From 300 BC forward, when you said baptized among the pagans, it meant to get rid of the demons. Among the Jews, it meant to enter into Israel. We're talking about this. I'm going to race the top of this so I got some place. It meant to enter into Israel. There was something called a proselyte, proselytes were brought into Israel. You remember when Jesus told the Pharisees, he said, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites." He said, "You'll do anything. You traverse sea and land. You'll do anything to make a proselyte." And after he's made, he said, "You make him twofold more the child of hell than yourselves." Now, Jesus wasn't very nice to Pharisees, was he? He didn't like them too well. People say, "Jesus loved everybody and Jesus is nice." No, he wasn't nice. Where do people ever come up with that? The word nice is N-I-S-C-E-R-E. Niskir is the French word. It comes from nay, meaning no, and S-C-I-E-N-C-E. Science is the word for science in the Greek is G-N-O-S-I-S, gnosis, and that means a knowledge of something. Well, the word nice, niskir, means no knowledge, no gnosis, no knowledge of anything. And when you act nice, you play dumb. Jesus didn't play dumb. He said hard words that were very cutting to the Pharisees. I raised something, forgot what I was going to say. Oh, by becoming a proselyte, when the Jews baptized someone, that was to become a proselyte into Israel. How you became a proselyte? Well, first of all, there were three things. One, two, three. Three things you had to do to be a proselyte. A proselyte is someone who is converted over from another religion into your religion. A proselyte was one who had to, that would be a Gentile. During the days of Jesus, all of the world was worshiping some form of the sun god. Not only that, every one of these sun gods, Hercules up here in Tyre or down here in Babylon, he was called Tammuz or Hercules down here. He was called Hercules up here in Rome. He was called Adonis over here in Greece. He was called Attis over here in what we call Asia Minor. He had all these names, but it was nothing but the deification of Nimrod. And when Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, all of the world was worshiping some form of the sun god. They were worshiping some form of deity that was said to be virgin born. And to come into Israel, you had to leave your land. Like, for instance, if you want to come from Ethiopia down here, or this little yellow spot right here, that's just about the state of Galatia. Galatia was a state in this area right here, what we call Turkey. And Paul, when Paul went and preached there in the 13th and 14th chapters of Acts, he preached at Antioch, came over here about 75 miles away, preached at Iconium, went about 20 miles south of there, preached at Lystra, they stoned him and left him for dead. Then he went down about 15 miles and went to Derbe there. That is the state of Galatia. If you were going to come, say, from Iconium, and you want to come down here and become a member of God's kingdom, they had a naturalization process. In that naturalization process, you had to be circumcised. Circumcised, that was the first thing. After the circumcision was healed, you had to be washed in water. Had to be washed in water. And then thirdly, you had to offer two turtle doves. This was the prescribed sacrifice of a newborn baby in Israel. You had to do these three things: circumcision, washing water, offer sacrifice. And of course, this is the same three things you had to do when you were a priest in Israel. And the scripture says in the 19th chapter of Exodus that Israel was a kingdom of priests. So you had to be circumcised, washed in water, and then offer sacrifice. Now, this washing in water was called a new birth. That's why when Nicodemus came to Jesus, being a ruler of the Jews, he was a member of the Sanhedrin, that 70-member judging council at Jerusalem. When Jesus said, "Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And Nicodemus said, "How can I be born again? I'm a Levite." He knew what new birth was. They call that a water baptism. That was the washing of the priesthood in Leviticus, the 8th chapter, in Exodus, the 29th chapter. And so Jesus says to him, Jesus says, he said, "That which is born of the flesh is flesh. He says that which is washed in water, that gets into the literal Israel. That brought you into a literal Israel. And he said that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. That gets into spiritual Israel. And that's why Paul said a Jew is not a Jew outwardly, but of the heart. Circumcision is not outward, but of the heart. And as many as walk according to the rule of a new creature there in the 6th chapter of Galatians, Paul said, peace be on them and upon the Israel of God. This is God's Israel, those who walk according to the new creation. So we're talking about a spiritual Israel. We're not talking about a literal Israel. That's what the water baptism was originally for. And people say, but Jim, the Bible talks about water baptism. We're going to address that too. The word baptize is the word B-A-P-T-I-Z-O, or the word bapto. Baptize or bapto originally was not, it was not it was originally, it was a word that meant to cover with a stain or dye. Strong said, I wrote it here on the bottom of my old Bible. He said, baptizo originally was not a verb. He said, baptizo originally not being a verb, verbs show action. I want to show you about this thing called washing in water because we don't understand this. We don't baptize in water around here. Because we believe that the handwriting of ordinances were nailed to the cross with Christ. We don't dip people in water. This word baptizo, I read from this last week. Let me read just one more time out of Mr. Girdlestone's. Y'all just make yourself at home. You ain't bother me. Let me read out of Mr. Girdlestone's synonyms of the Old Testament. I read a paragraph out of this last week, but let me read the one paragraph to you again. The English translators did not translate the word baptized, and they acted wisely, for there is no word in the English language which is an exact counterpart of the Greek word as the New Testament uses it. There is no word that we can translate containing the precise ideas of the evangelist, neither less nor more. The difficulty, or rather the excellency of the word, is that it contains two ideas, inclusive of the whole doctrine of baptism. Baptize is a dyer's word. It's a word about dyeing articles or clothing, and signifies to dip so as to color something. When you were baptized, you didn't get unbaptized. Such as render the word dip, give one true idea, but the word stood for two, and one is wanting in this rendering. He's saying that the word baptize had to do with covering something, never uncovering it, and to stain it with a dye. In fact, when you find this, look over here in, let me read the rest of this, then I want to go to 1 Peter, the 3rd chapter. Baptizo not being a verb implying motion is properly followed in the Greek by the preposition en. That is not our word. We translated that in, and we don't know what that means. That is not the meaning of that word. We translated in, denoting the means or method with the instrumental dative. The dative case is the indirect object, which has unfortunately often been rendered by the ambiguous particle in. That's an ambiguous term. When we think of in, baptizing them in, we think of moving into and coming out of. It doesn't mean that. It means to stain with a dye. He's washed us from our sins in his own blood. There is one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. I'm going to go to that in a minute. Whereas it really, in this connection, signifies with or by. When you use the word en with the word baptizo, it just means with something or by it. Actually, the word baptizo means a rushing of the fluid upon something. It did not mean to move the subject into the water and take them out. We don't even understand this. I've got some church historians, if I can find one of them quickly here. Let me see here. Yeah, let me give you how they baptized, if they baptized in water in the early church. If I can find it here. Y'all hold on, y'all ain't gonna leave, are you? All right. Well, I thought I had it. If they would baptize in the early church, they did not do what we do. They would dip a man in water. That must be in one of my other books. They would dip a man in water. As they would dip him in water, he was supposed to curse the devil, spit in his face, and then he was supposed to, coming up, he had to be washed in running water. They called that living water. If he couldn't be washed in running cold water, then he could be washed in warm water, and then he had to drink a glass of milk and drink some honey. And then he was baptized, and they only did that at the Passover. Now, that's what the early church did when they did it as a ritual. But baptize had an exact meaning. It meant a way of coming into the kingdom. Let's take our Bibles. Let's take our Bibles, and I want to go over here. I want to go to 1 Peter. 1 Peter, and I want to show you this. 1 Peter, and I'm going to walk through some of this with you. Let me read some more of this. By becoming a proselyte, converted to the worship of Jehovah God of Israel. A demon or daemonion was a deity or a god. Now, baptism had to do with casting out devils. That's what it had to do with. Baptism among the pagans had to do with casting out devils. The word daemon, you've got two words for devil in the Greek. D-I-A-B-O-L-O-S, diabolos. Then you have the word D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. Don't look for the word demon in a King James Bible. It's not there. The word demon is not in the Bible. It is the word daemonion, and that word comes from the root D-A-I-O. That word means to distribute fortunes, is what it means. Now, you've got two doctrines in Scripture. You've got the doctrine. You got the doctrine of fulfill the flesh, and then you have the doctrine of crucifying the flesh. Now, what the doctrine that Jesus preaches, anyone who preaches fulfill the flesh, you can have all the money you want, you can have all the things you want, you can be rich, you can do what you want to do. That is the doctrine of daemonion. Over there in 1 Timothy 4:1, in the latter time some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. That word devil is daemonion, and it means to distribute fortunes. What did Satan tell Jesus when he took him up on a high mountain in Luke 4? And over there in Matthew 4, he said, fall down and worship me and I'll give you the fortunes of the world. Isn't that what he's saying? Yes, he did. And a daemon was a deity or a god. Is there actually other gods beside Jehovah God? When you look that up, do you actually believe that Jesus believed those guys had demons in them? He did not believe that. That was a superstition in that day and time. Before I go to 1 Peter, let me just kind of back that up with you. Go over here to Mark 1. Go to Mark 1, because baptism has to do with getting rid of demons. Go to Mark 1, and we'll look at this. For those of you that haven't been here, and I'm having to cover this, baptism had to do with getting rid of the demons. It had to do with getting rid of an evil spirit, one who possessed an ancestor who possessed someone's body. Now, I want us to, and those ancestors, that they call that having fellowship with their ancestors, and their ancestors, they would talk to them. That's what Jay-Z Knight does out there in California. Y'all know who she is. She's got all these followers like Linda Evans and several other of those big movie stars, and they follow her, and she says she talks to a 30,000-year-old counselor. The only thing we're possessed, I said it down here at the end of this, I said, we're not possessed by our ancestors. We possess our ancestors because what they've given us is this lust of the flesh. so that we can distribute fortunes to ourselves, so we can distribute the goods of this world. We're not to take any thought for our life, what we eat, or what we drink, or how we'll be clothed, are we? Are we supposed to do that? Take no thought for your life, what you'll eat or drink, or how you'll be clothed. Because your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. He said, consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They don't toil, they don't spin. Yet I say unto you that Solomon in all of his glories was not as arrayed as one of these lilies of the field. He said, seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. He will take care of the food and the clothing and the shelter. That's what he'll do. Look over here in Mark, the first chapter. I hadn't brought this out in a while. Let me just show you. And I go through all these verses. You have to understand something. In the first century, they said they had good demons and bad demons, or daimonions, good deities and bad deities. They said the good demons, that's like the little angel on your shoulder in one of the cartoons, and he's got a halo, and then he got the demon over here, and he's got the horns, and this one's telling you to do good, and this one's telling you to do bad. They said a good demon would get you a good job. A good demon would get you a raise. A good demon would give you a good crop. A good demon, you'd have plenty of sheep, lots of wool. A good demon would give you a good life, a good, easy life. A bad demon would break your leg. A bad demon would get you fired. A bad demon would make you sick. They called everything demons. That's what they called it. In fact, the Jews called their vices and their sins, they named them daimonion. They called the fire a demon, the wind a demon, the water was a demon. Everything was a demon. And they were always running in fear of everything in their life. But let me show you that Jesus didn't believe that. And the demons were cast out by baptism. I've got a whole section of Hastings Encyclopedia that talks about that. A vampire was said to be a demon. How did you get him? This comes out of, boy, I go from one thing to the other faster than I can. But a vampire, let me slow down here. Vampire is not something the movies invented. This comes out of Hastings Encyclopedia. Vampire, that's Hastings Encyclopedia, was printed in 1906. That's long before these movie producers. In fact, my encyclopedias are very old. They're back early 1900s. Mine were printed. Let me just read to you, vampire. How do you get rid of a vampire? Baptism? Don't you have to sprinkle holy water on him? Supposedly. That's true. Let me read this to you. A vampire may be defined as the spirit of a dead person or his corpse reanimated by his own spirit or by a demon. This is early 1900s. It was the spirit of a dead person or a dead ancestor living in this person, returning to sap the life of the living by depriving them of blood. Blood baptism? All of this is a twisting of the truth. By depriving them of blood, a blood baptism was a death in the first century, or of some essential organ in order to augment its own vitality. This forms a particular aspect of the general belief that ghosts or spirits sent by sorcerers can annoy the living in various ways or cause their sickness or death. That's what they said demons caused. The vampire is often one who has died an untimely death or whose afterlife is unhappy or dead sorcerer, wizard, or other obnoxious person. Then he says the boundary line between life and death seems to have been but vaguely defined. To prevent the return of the dead, whether bodily or as a ghost, many precautions were in use. Enclosing the grave with a high fence, piling heavy stones upon it, or diverting the course of a stream, water, you could baptize the demon away. In order to bury in its bed, you could keep the demon away by baptism. That's what you could do. Now let me read to you what a demon was out of the Encyclopedia Judaica. The Judaica is a set of Jewish encyclopedias, 17-volume set. Let me read to you what a demon is. The Israelite conception of demons as it existed in the popular mind or the literary imagination resembled in some ways that held elsewhere. Demons live in deserts or ruins in Leviticus 16 and 10, Isaiah 13 and 21, 34 and 14. They inflict sickness on men. That's what the vampire did, and he was possessed with a demon. They trouble men's minds in 1 Samuel 16, 15 and 23, and deceive them, 1 Kings 22, 22 through 23. But nevertheless, these evil spirits are sent by the Lord. That's what the Bible says. An evil spirit from God entered into Saul. The mysterious being who attacked Jacob in Genesis 32, 25 exhibits a trait which a very widespread belief associated with certain demons who are spirits of the night and must perish at dawn. That's what a demon was to a Jew. Wait a minute, I believe that what is it that perishes at dawn? The vampire, doesn't he? In the light. What is it that destroys the demon or destroys self? Light, which is equated with truth, and that's Christ. All of this stuff goes together. Look here in Mark, the first chapter. Look at verse 23. And there was in a synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. Unclean is neuter gender. And cried out, saying, let us alone. Let us alone is not in the text. You say, how do you know? Well, I can read it out of this interlinear Bible. It's not there. They stuck it in there. Let us alone. What have we to do with thee? Now, the word with is the word soi. It comes from the word sum. Sum means to accompany or be in fellowship with. And when we are to be in fellowship with Christ, we preach on Wednesday night about predestination, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed. Conformed is the word sum, morphos. Sum means in fellowship with or to accompany, and we're not to have any fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness. Ye were darkness, but now are ye light. That's where they get the thing about the vampire. They perish with the light. The demons are self perishes with the light. Sumorphos, morphos is the word morphe, and that means to be shaped in fellowship with. Soi is a derivative of the word sum, and the old ancients said that this word soi was a, they said that was the feminine demons through the father's side of the family. That's what they said it was. Or the spirits of an ancestor possessing. You remember when Jesus said to the man, in Luke, the 8th chapter, the man of the Gadarenes, he didn't say, what is your name? He said, Tisoi, estinonoma. He said, what fellowship represents authority in your life? And the man said, legion, L-E-G-I-O-N. And that's plural, and it's feminine gender. And he said, I got all these female demons in me. I got all these female deities in me. I got all these female gods in me. Now, Jesus certainly didn't believe that, because every time after that, when he would refer to devils, he would refer to it in neuter gender. He was saying they don't exist. Later on in the chapter, the man came to his right mind. You mean he came to his right mind sitting at the feet of Jesus? And when Jesus said, Tisoi estino noma, when he said, what fellowship represents authority in your life? And he gives Jesus the answer, and he's out of his mind. Jesus is actually going to believe him? Jesus didn't believe what he said. In fact, when they came out and found him sitting at the feet of Jesus, they wanted to know by what means the man was healed, and the word healed is S-O-Z-O, sozo, and that's the word saved. They wanted to know by what means he was saved. So when the man was with, look here, let's go back here. Now, the man is talking in the plural, isn't he? The man is talking in plural. There was a certain man in a synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, what have we plural. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee, who thou art, the Holy One of God. But Jesus didn't rebuke the demons. Look at who he rebuked. The next verse. The man is saying, feminine gender, we. And Jesus says, and Jesus rebuked him. He did not rebuke them. And the word him is A-U-T-O. Alpha, Upsilon, Tau, Omega. A-U-T-O. What is an automobile? An automobile is self-mobile. Yep, that's right. This word auto is self, masculine gender. Jesus did not rebuke them, feminine gender. He rebuked self. He rebuked the man. There's no possible way that he believed he had gods in him. Jesus rebuked him, saying, hold thy peace and come out of him. He's saying, self, come out. It's because the man was elect, is what it was. And when the unclean, neuter gender spirit, what is a clean spirit?
Holy.
Holy. Holy spirit. Holy is the word hagios, H-A-G-I-O-S. That means pure or single. That means the Holy Spirit has no corruption in it. And the word spirit is P-N-E-U-M-A. We get our word pneumonia from that. Pneuma. And pneuma means breath. There's a pure breath and there's an impure breath. This breath that we breathe here in this body, this we breathe when we're living in the flesh, we're living in it to serve self. And until Jesus comes along and teaches us to crucify the flesh and die to self, and he has to do that by a blood baptism. A blood baptism was a death. When Jesus said, can you be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with to James and John and Mark 10, he was talking about a death. And that was the night before he died on a cross. They called a cross a baptism. He wasn't talking about, John, can you be dipped in water? Have you ever been dipped in water before? Are you able to? It's not what he was saying. Let's read on here. And when the unclean spirit had torn him and cried with a loud voice, look at the next word, or next three words. He came out. That's the Bible talking, isn't it? That isn't the man, or that isn't Jesus talking, is it? He came out. Well, if he is in the text, then a masculine gender person came out of the man. And I've got a real problem there if something could come out of the man that was actually a being. But see, there's one thing about it. That's what these are good for, these interlinears. That word he is not in the text. It just says, and came out. I'd have a problem with that, wouldn't I? Sure would. But it says, and came out of him. It's the neuter gender spirit in the first part of that verse. Neuter means it has no gender. It doesn't exist. And they were all amazed insomuch that they questioned among themselves, saying, what thing is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority commandeth he even the unclean spirits. Now, who's this talking? This is the people talking around him, isn't it? Yeah, these are the doctors of the law, the Pharisees and the scribes. He commandeth even the unclean spirits, and they do obey him. They and unclean spirits, they say, neuter gender, plural. Wait a minute. The man says, we, feminine gender, plural. The Pharisees say, they, unclean spirits, neuter gender, plural. Jesus said, no, mister, you, self, masculine gender, singular. That's what Jesus said. You see, we don't realize the man was lying, the Pharisees were lying, but Jesus was telling the truth. We don't understand that. There is no such thing as demons. These people that wallow in the floor, if you'll go over there, if they're demons, then they're out of control. If there's actually a God in them, because the word daemon and the word theos were interchangeable in the first century. You make that up, Jim Brown? No, I didn't make it up. You can get out of dozens of books. Theos and the word daemon. Theos is the word God. There's no other gods beside one. That's what amazes me. When anybody looks that up, it'll say it comes from a word meaning distribute fortunes, and it's a god. It's a deity. You actually believe that Jesus walked up to a man, and the guy says, I've got all these gods in me. Jesus says, you do. He rebuked the man, not them. Nobody ever notices that, though, do they? Because nobody decides to get a parsing guide. If you need a parsing guide, I got all kinds of parsing guides. I got one up here. Well, I thought I had them. Here's one right here. Here's a parsing guide. It'll tell you what it is. Here's a parsing guide. This will tell you what gender. It'll tell you what I can show. This right here, anybody can use this. I can take brand new people and show them how to use this and look up what gender something is, how to look up the person, how to look up whether it's a noun or a verb or a participle or an infinitive. Anybody can do it. It's very simple. Now, let's go over here. Let's look at, now, baptism drives out self is what it does. Let me read some of the rest. Let's go to 1 Peter. 1 Peter, because I got to get on with this. 1 Peter. 1 Peter. Chapter 3. 1 Peter 3. And verse 18. For Christ also has once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. Being put to death and quickened is called the gospel. That's called the resurrection. The resurrection is by which he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. The resurrection is the gospel. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Paul said, I declare unto you the gospel, that which I also received, how that Christ was dead, buried, and resurrected again the third day. That's the means by which he went and preached to the spirits in prison. Of course, the word prison is the word phulake, P-H-U-L-A-K-E. That means the division of light. Think of vampires and darkness. Think of demons, light and darkness. The light drives out the demons. The light drives out self. It's what it does. Causes self to cease to desire to distribute fortunes to self. That's the division of light and darkness. That's the word prison. And the word forgiveness, A-P-H-E-S-I-S, means to pardon and release from prison. And forgiveness comes by repentance. And repentance is a response to rebuke when a man has a hearing ear. Now, look over, let's continue here. I'll get back to this in a minute. By which he also went and preached to the spirits in prison. The spirits in prison were the Gentiles. They lived in darkness. They had no truth. They had no light. From Abraham all the way to Christ, God had given his spirit to one flesh. And in the end times, he's going to pour out of his spirit on all flesh. Red, yellow, white, black, and brown flesh. And the Holy Spirit is the truth. John 14, 16, 17. John 15, 26. John 16, 13. 1 John 5 and 6. The Spirit is the truth. The Holy Spirit is some not mystic thing, and demons aren't either. They are self. If you go over there next time, if somebody wallows in the floor and they got a demon, they're spitting at the mouth. If you get up there and say, if you don't behave yourself, just whisper in there, if you don't get up out of that floor, I'm going to stomp you right in the face. I bet you a dollar they'll get up. What do you bet? That ain't something making them wallow. You're going to have to deal with this parsing of these words. Look at verse 20. Which sometime were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls were saved. Now it says in the King James, by water. But the word in the original text is dia. Through water. The water was not the baptism. Let's turn over there and look, see what the baptism was. Go over there to Genesis 6, 14. Genesis 6. I've quoted this so many times, but Genesis 6:14, when the Lord tells Noah to build an ark, here's what he says to him. 6, verse 14. He says, Noah, build an ark of gopher wood. Very strong wood. Build an ark of gopher wood. Room shalt thou make in the ark, and shalt pitch it within and without with pitch. You pitch it within and without with pitch. There's two words for pitch in the Hebrew. The first word pitch is a verb. The second word pitch is a noun. The first word pitch is kafar. The second word pitch is kofar. Kafar, the first word pitch, the verb form, is the exact same word as atonement all the way through the scripture. On the Day of Atonement, the 10th day of the 7th month, the high priest would enter in behind the veil of the ark, the veil. He had a veil. The temple would face east. Here's west over here, north. And on the south side of the outer holy place, the holy place, and the Holy of Holies was on the inside. And you had an 8-inch thick veil here on the north side of the holy place was the table of showbread. Then you had the altar of incense. They would set it real close to that veil. And on the south side of the holy place, you had the 7 candlesticks. Inside the Holy of Holies, you had one piece of furniture. That was the Ark of the Covenant with the cherubim on it facing one another. On the 10th day of the 7th month, the priest on the Day of Atonement would go in behind that veil and he would sprinkle 7 times. 7 is the number of a blood baptism all the way through Scripture. God tells Israel, I'll multiply your sins. I'll punish you 7 times for your sins. He says it 4 times, and he mentions his 4 judgments, the sword, the famine, the pestilence, and the beast. He says 4 times, I'll punish you 7 times for your sins. You've got 7 all the way through the Scripture. You've got 7 candlesticks. That is the church. That's the refined church there in Revelation, the 1st chapter. 7 trumpets, 7 seals, 7 vials. Naaman had to be dipped 7 times in the Jordan. 70 times 7 was the number of the 70 weeks of Daniel. 7 all the way through the Scripture. I don't have time to go to all that. But look here. The like figure, as 8 souls were saved through water, the like figure, when to even baptism doth also now save us, pitch the ark with pitch. The first word pitch means to cover. The second word pitch means to stain with a dye. Pitch with pitch has the exact same meaning as baptism. If he's washed us from our sins in his own blood, and he has, true baptism is not H2O. It is the blood of Christ. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Who are these standing before the throne of God in Revelation 7? Why, these are those who have made their robes white in the blood of Christ. The white robe was what the wife had to wear when she went to the marriage ceremony. If you're not washed in a blood baptism, which was a death, Jesus said in the 12th chapter of Luke, there, starting in about that 50th verse, he talks about, I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how am I straight until it be accomplished? This was after he had been dipped in water. You say, Jim, what happened to that? What happened to that baptism? Let's go over here to, let's go to Ephesians. Let's go to Ephesians. Mr. Ephesians, the 4. Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4. Water, being dipped in water. Have I been dipped in water? I was sprinkled as a Methodist when I was a little kid, little baby. My father was a Methodist song leader. Then he became a Baptist preacher, preaching Accept Christ when I was 10 years old. And ever since then, I had to go out there and had to try to accept Christ, and I got dipped in water about 8 times by several preachers. He dipped me about 4 or 5 because I wasn't sure of my salvation. Well, you can't know with all your heart. No one can know. I know. Well, I know. That's not even our word know. When Paul said, I know whom I have believed. When he said, these things have I written to you, John said that you may know that you have eternal life. That's not our word know. When people use that to say, I know, I'm not even going to go there now. You want to talk about that? We'll talk about it after church. But Mr. Strong, one of the great scholars of all time, says the statement that the primary force of the verb baptizo is to dip or immerse is not sustained by its actual usage and grammatical construction. It does not just mean to immerse somebody in water. It has to do with the movement of the fluid. That's what it has to do with. Come on in. Come on in here. All right, let's look here in Ephesians 4 and 5. There's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Let me put this word one on the board for you. You see this word one? Three times he mentions one, doesn't he? Huh? Let me show you how bad they've translated the Bible. Those are three completely different words. We got one way to spell it. For those of you that haven't been here before, here's a chart, just the declension. You say, I don't know what declension means. Declension means to decline. It means to go down through the sentence, start with the nominative case, with the subject, go down to the genitive and the dative and the accusative case. This is the direct object, the accusative is. Singular, plural, masculine, feminine, neuter, gender in the singular, masculine, feminine, neuter, gender in the plural. You see all these 24 words here? That's 24 different ways to spell the word the, T-H-E. Now, how are you going to translate that into English? And guess what? You got 24 ways to spell the word good. The only problem is you got two different words that we translated from the Greek, kalos and agathos. We know that all things work together for good. Agathos, that's what God does in our life. And he said unto him that knoweth to do good, the last verse of the fourth chapter of James, unto him that knoweth to do good, that's the word kalos. They took kalos and agathos, the translators, and made it into one word and called it good. You mean what I do, what God causes me to do for him, and what he does in my life is the same thing? No, it is not. So therefore, they've taken two different words, made them the same word in the English, and you got 24 ways to spell kalos and 24 ways to spell agathos. All of our English versions are wrong. People say, why do you look up these Greek words, Jim? Because this thing is a mess. Does it upset me? Greatly. You can have a copy of that if you want it. I can take a, just open this. Here's Mr. Machen. He's probably the most famous of the scholars in the world for the first half of this century on Greek books. Here's the word the. I took that out here and enlarged it. Here's the word agathos. There's 24, 25, 26, 27. 27 ways to spell the word agathos. I forgot that's in the, they have a vocative case on that. So you got 27 ways to spell agathos. Here's the word small. You got 27 ways to spell small. You got a vocative case on that. You got a vocative case on righteous. You got 27 ways to spell that. You got 24 ways to spell greater. Do you think this matters? It is all important. And that's what's wrong with these scholars. I use that term loosely. They don't care. I care. I'm not trying to take a vote. God's a majority of one. He's the only one who took a vote. He took it before the foundation of the world. And his is the only vote that counts. You can come up here and look through Mr. Machen's book. Mr. Machen said, if there's one thing that a man will not allow, he will not allow us, a man will not allow you to come up and ask you to define a word that's appalling to a man. Well, I'm sorry, but I'm going to define them here, and I don't really care if all the big famous preachers like it or not. Let me put this up here. One Lord, one faith, one Lord. The first word, one Lord, is E-I-S. But it's got a little... You remember that word, baptizing them in the name over there in Matthew 28. Let me show you this. Just flip over there to Matthew 28. Matthew 28. Matthew 28, verse 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in. That word is E-I-S. Now, the word over there, one Lord, is the word E-I-S. Are those the same word right there? Huh? You better look at that again.
No, it's not.
This, the one Lord has got a dia. Now, most of you would have looked that up and thought, most of you, if you looked it up, you would have gotten confused, wouldn't you? One Lord, and this says baptized in. This has no diacritical mark. The diacritical mark is an H sound. It's actually H-E-I-S, Is. And this is Is baptizing them in. This means this is a cardinal number. It's masculine gender. It's masculine gender. So whenever they used an adjective, adjectives modify nouns and pronouns. A noun and a pronoun is a person, place, or thing. An adjective tells which, what kind of, how many. When they used an adjective, they put their gender in their adjective. And they always, you can tell what the gender it is. You can tell what gender it is simply by the adjective. Now, he said, when there's one Lord, one faith. Now the word one faith, the word one there, is the word mia. Let me write it down in the Greek, M-I-A. M looks like an upside down H. Their I looks like our I with a little curl on the bottom. And their A looks like our A. Mia. Now that word means a certain particular kind. It doesn't mean any old faith you want it to be. It is not what Kenneth Copeland says. Faith is not wishing you can get what you want. Faith is dying. That's what it is. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Substance, over there in Hebrews 11 and 1, is the word hypostasis. I don't think I put a word on the board more time than I put this on the board. Hupo means under or through. It actually means under. And stasis means stand. The Bible says there is none that understandeth. Faith is understanding God. Well, if there's none that understandeth, from the word stasis, we get the word S-T-A-U-R-O-S. That is the word cross. In order to understand the Word of God, you have to bear your cross. Didn't Jesus say, if you don't bear your cross and follow me, you can't be my disciple? I've had people say, well, I'm not a scholar. Well, you better be. Yes, that's a nice way to argue. The word scholar is the word disciple. The word disciple is the word M-A-T-H-E-T-E-S, mathetes. We get our word mathematics from that. And the Bible says you cannot know what God is saying unless you follow the rules of the book. God's got a mathematics book we have to follow. Well, I'm not a scholar like you. That's the excuse a lot of people use for being lazy and never picking up their Bible. So if you say I'm not a scholar, the word methetes, disciple, means a scholar or a learner. It means to be a student of the Word. I'm no student of the Word. I don't bear my cross. If somebody tells you there in Luke 14 and 27, I'm not a scholar. The Bible says they're not bearing their cross daily. And Jesus said in Luke 9:23, any man comes after me, deny self, take your cross and follow me every day. What do you mean you're not a scholar? That means you're not a follower of Christ. I like what one preacher said. He said, you don't have to teach babies to want milk. somewhere along the way, if you're a believer, you're going to want this word somewhere along the way. And you're going to want, these things are going to matter what these things mean. Am I upset at the preachers? I've been studying the Bible for 42 years. My father was an old country Baptist preacher. I woke up at 18 years old in 1957. I just getting out of high school. And I'm thinking, God, you're an awful ignorant God. If this is all there is, my father would read two verses and tell stories and boast and brag and try to make people laugh for 45 minutes. I never heard anything from him. Jim, are you? Why, that's your father. My father's in heaven. My mother's Jerusalem, according to the fourth chapter of Galatians. Unless a man hate his mother, father, sister, brother, and himself also, he cannot be my disciple. You can't be a learner unless you get rid of your boundary lines, unless you get rid of those family lines, unless you get rid of your denomination. I couldn't see the truth as long as I was holding on to boundary lines. I don't know about my father. He died last June. If he came into a room with me, it petrified him because he thought I was going to start talking about the Bible. He was a retired Baptist preacher, and he knew less about the Bible than any preacher I ever met in my life. That's disgusting. You're going to lead sheep and just give them any old food to eat? Here's some garbage. Eat that. Look here. There's one faith. It means a certain kind. Faith cometh by hearing. Oh, there in Romans 10:17, the word here is A-K-O-U-O, and the word obey in the New Testament is hoopakuo, A-K-O-U-O. This word hoop means under. This means to hear under or to be subordinate to. Who are we subordinate to? Christ. Do we have to obey Him? When you're subordinate, you have to obey. We don't obey to be. We do not obey God in order to be in His family. We obey Him because we are His children. And if we don't, He'll beat us and scourge us, won't He? And there's one baptism. That is the word. Boy, that's hard. Those of y'all that know this word. Oh, me. Peter said to the house of Cornelius, he said, he commanded them to be baptized in the name. And that word in is E-N, except this word right here, one baptism, is not E-N, it is diacritical mark, E-N. That is the word H-E-N. And that is the neuter gender of, that's the neuter gender of he's. This is masculine, this is neuter gender. Boy, that's really going to get confusing, isn't it? Let's turn over here to, I want to take you to a place I've been wanting to show you something. Let's go over to Acts 10. Acts 10. And verse. Now, I'm going to go through this slow. I'm not going to try to make Greek scholars out of you. I've got a purpose in what I'm saying here. I want you to understand. I have never heard anybody talk about a blood baptism except maybe Matthew Henry, except maybe Alfred Edersheim, except maybe the Apostle Paul, the Apostle Peter, except the Apostle John, except Jesus Christ. They speak of a blood baptism. That's what a cross was. When we're baptized into His death in the sixth chapter of Romans, how did He die? On a cross. How are we baptized into His death? First of all, let me say this. I don't know if I've got the thing up here. Yeah, here it is. I keep some things up here just in case. Now, when we say baptize, somebody goes in the baptistry and they go, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Well, if they're going to be covered, they have to be stained with a dye. You got to put some food coloring in there. It needs to be red, preferably. And it's got to be permanent so it'll never come off. If it starts wearing off and as their cells start reproducing, you need to go by the church and kind of be painted with some red paint or something. Because the word baptized means to be covered with a stain or dye, and it means never to be uncovered. The word east that we were talking about over there in Matthew, the 28th chapter, baptizing them in, that word east has the idea it is a synonym for the word pros, meaning to move forward, toward, or into, but it never does mean to come out of. If it meant to dip something in and then take it out, you'd have to have something along the line of the word EK involved in it. Because EK is the word ek, and we get our word exit from that. That word means out of, or from outside of. But this word is not connected with baptize. This word means to move into and never come out. I have heard John MacArthur say that. He said, well, if we actually baptize people the way they should, we'd put them in the water and we wouldn't let them up. But you see, water is not it. H2O is not it. It's not it at all. Let me read this to you. We think of burial, buried with him in baptism. We think of putting somebody 6 feet under the ground, don't we? That buried with him in baptism, that's an Americanization of burial. They didn't bury people in the ground 6 feet under. They didn't do it. Let me read to you. This is the word tomb. This comes out of McLennan's and Strong's Encyclopedia. Let me just read this thing. I've read it so many times. At Hebron, he's talking about tombs, the tomb of Rachel, of David, of Samuel, the tomb. How do you make a tomb? Do you get a shovel or a backhoe and dig a hole in the ground? Is that a tomb? They didn't bury their people in the ground. They buried them in tombs. At Hebron, there is the Jewish burying ground covered with the large slabs and curious tombs cut in the rock with loculi on all sides, which are probably patriarchal or at least Jewish. Around Jerusalem, there are numerous tombs, many of them remarkable for their beauty, their size, their peculiar structure. Almost all of these are Jewish and give us a good idea of how the manner of Jews was to bury. Christianity is Jewish. You do know that, don't you? Water baptism comes from the washing of the priesthood in Leviticus 8 and Exodus 29. Whoever could afford it chose the rock, not the earth, for the covering of his body and preferred to have his body deposited on a clean rocky shelf, not let down into and covered over with soil. Hence, our ideas of burial are not the same as those of the Jews. Buried with him in baptism cannot mean dropping a man down into a hole. According to us, there is always the letting down into the earth, buried with him in baptism. And the Greek professors know this. According to them, there is the taking possession of some stony chamber for the last sleep. Hence, the expression buried with him by baptism into death would not to a Hebrew suggest immersion, as it seems to do to us and to the early Christian. The symbol of baptismal burial would be associated with the Lord's own tomb, and the tombs were in the sides of hills and mountains. So if you're going to have a physical baptism, and it's going to be a literal thing, and you're going to do it in water, you need one of those great big fans like they had in the Ten Commandments, so you can blow a wall of water up here and dip a man sideways.
Except you could never pull him out.
You could never pull him out. We could do it, get a waterfall. We could do that. Build our own waterfall sideways. And you got to run some dye with it. People say, but I like my baptism. We'll keep it. I tell you, I wrestled with this thing from the time I was a kid. Let's go to the first people that Peter preached to in Acts 10. Go to Acts 10. Peter goes to the house of Cornelius. Where he goes. House of Cornelius. He goes to the house of Cornelius. Cornelius is a Gentile. This is the first time the Gentiles are preached to. Peter did not want to preach to the Gentiles. He knew that according to the Old Testament scripture that we weren't supposed to be eating with them, having fellowship with them, talking to them. God had cut them off from all of the Word, all of His Word, for the first 4,000 years. God always said, go in there and kill them, but don't give them the truth. Go down to Amalek and utterly destroy them. Go to Mount Moab and kill them. Go to the land of Ammon and kill them, but don't give them truth. He didn't give the Gentiles truth till Acts 2. And Peter had a hard time being convinced of this. So God drops a sheet out of heaven and he says, kill and eat. And Peter said, I've never eaten anything common or unclean. And God said, don't you call the Gentiles, which I have cleansed, common or unclean. Go to the house of Cornelius. And this is the first time the Gentiles were Gentiles. Gentiles are all those pagan heathens who are not Jews. That's us, everybody here, unless we got some literal Jews here. But a Jew is not outward, it's of the heart, and circumcision is the heart, and so is baptism. If there's one baptism, and He has washed us from our own sins in His own blood, and if it's this washing of regeneration, according to Titus, that saves us, it is not water, not H2O, it is living water, the blood of Christ. But see, when you get to talking about the true baptism, you're talking about getting rid of self. You're talking about a death to self. You're talking about a daily cross. You're talking about getting rid of the demon of self. Daemon, distributing fortunes, the desire to fulfill the flesh. You're talking about getting rid of the one thing your ancestors gave to you. It's not a spirit of your ancestor. It's self. Unless we crucify self, we can't be His disciples. Let's read here. I want to read something to you. This is very, very important to conjugate these words. Conjugate means to divide the sentence up into parts of speech. And I'm going to show you why. This thing of dipping in water, even the church didn't used to do that way. Are we in a mess? We are. The early church fathers knew the truth. They knew the truth about the Lord's Supper. They knew there was no Lord's Supper. They knew it was a meal. They knew that when Jesus said, this bread is my body, in verse 26 of Matthew 26, they were eating the Passover in verse 17. The apostles come to Jesus and said, where wilt thou that we should eat the Passover? They weren't eating crackers and grape juice. They had a lamb without blemish. They had unleavened bread for 7 days. They had four cups. The third cup was called the cup of blessing. And they had wormwood, which was bitter herbs. And Christ is our Passover in the 5th chapter of 1 Corinthians. And we, the church, being many, are one bread and one body. And the third cup being the cup of blessing, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 10, 16, he used a Passover term when he said, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? To drink of a cup meant to undergo a death. It had the same meaning as a baptism. What's amazing, true baptism is about coming out of Babylon, and the Passover was about coming out of Egypt, wasn't it? The Passover was about leaving Egypt, wasn't it? What do you mean the baptism was about coming out of Babylon? Didn't John come preaching the baptism of repentance as it was written in the book of Isaiah in the 3rd chapter of Luke, there verses 3 and 4? Isn't that what the Bible says? As it was written in the book of Isaiah, you mean Isaiah preached baptism? Yes, he did. Luke 3:3-4, the Bible says that John came preaching the baptism of repentance, which was prepare ye the way of the Lord, make His path straight. Well, that was Isaiah's words in Isaiah 40:3, when Isaiah was prophesying about Israel being carried into Babylonian captivity. He said, prepare the highway in the desert for the Lord from Babylon back to Jerusalem. That was about an exit from Babylon. Babylon was the mother of harlots, and she was built upon self. Or Genesis 11:4, let us make us a name. Self. It's about coming out of self. And it was about a 600-mile trek back to Israel. And there was nothing there because Nebuchadnezzar had destroyed it. And it was a baptism to go over there. It was a severe ordeal to go over there and start over again with God. The crackers and grape juice is not it. That's the Passover. Baptism in water is not it. That's leaving Babylon and leaving the demons or leaving self. That's what it is. I'm just starting to work on this. Look here. Verse 44, chapter 10 of Acts. How much time do I have? 20. Look at this. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them, talking about the house of Cornelius. This is the first Gentiles that ever heard the word of God. It was Peter who stood up. In Acts the 15th chapter, he said, the Gentiles by my mouth first heard the word of the gospel. And he's talking about this right here. Fell on them which heard the word, and they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. And what is the Holy Ghost? The Holy Ghost, the word ghost is pneuma. It's the same word as spirit. Upon them was poured out the truth. The Gentiles had never received the truth. For 4,000 years from Adam until Christ, the truth was never given to the Gentiles. It was given to one flesh, and that was Seth, Adam. Seth took the place of Abel. Seth all the way down through Noah, Shem, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons. His name was changed to Israel. One flesh received the truth. One flesh received the truth. And then in the last days, the last 2,000 years, God's going to pour out of His Spirit on the Gentiles or all flesh, those who were in prison for this all this period of time, and from Adam all the way to Christ. The Gentiles never received the truth. So He says, the Gentiles received the gift of the truth. Thy word is truth. The Holy Spirit is truth. They received the word of God for the first time. For they heard them speak with glossa, foreign languages, tongues. It doesn't mean jabbering. And magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any forbid water? It doesn't say can any forbid water in the original text. Because forbid looks like a verb, doesn't it? This is very, very important, people. It's very important. It doesn't say can any forbid water. Forbid, it says the water to forbid. It doesn't say to. The word to is incorporated in the word. This word forbid is an infinitive. You say, I don't know what that means. Does that mean nothing to me? It means something to Jeanette. She's an English teacher. Now, she can put her fingers in her ears till we get to the important part here. Okay? Infinitive. This is very important. It's an infinitive. An infinitive is a verbal noun. Now, it is a noun in the sentence. It's like taking a verb. Taking a verb, you say, how can a verb be a noun? If you were a policeman and you had infiltrated the mafia, and one of your friends come up and said, hey, John, while you were the mafia guy, you'd go over to him and say, you blew my cover. Cover can be a noun or a verb, can it? Or what if I said, you're right down the street, and I want you to go over here, and I want you to stop and pick up this one guy. There'll be three guys on the corner, and one of them will be covered. And you said, which one is the covered? The covered means covered would be a noun. We do the same thing. That's the way they talk. You have to understand they had something called semantics. When you're talking about semantics, that's not some word that they mention on Johnny Carson's show at night. Semantics means the way they use their language. It was completely different than the way we use ours. Now, I don't know about in the English, Jeanette can tell us about that, but let me read to you about an infinitive. A Greek infinitive contains tense, something that is not clear in English infinitives. The Greek infinitive is always a verbal noun. It is a noun. If I say verbal, verbal tells what kind of. Now this will confuse you. What kind of? Now what tells what kind of? An adjective. So verbal would actually be an adjective when I say a verbal noun. It tells you what kind of a noun it is. It is a noun. When Peter goes on to say baptize, let's read on down to the next verse. I'll give you this, and it'll be easier. Can any forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized. To be baptized is an infinitive also. Baptized is an infinitive. Baptized. That means that is a noun, but it is verbal in character. A verb show action. So it's a noun, but nouns are persons. Let me say this real slow. Persons, places, or thing. A verb shows action. Or if it's a being verb or a helping verb, what the Greeks, in the Greek studies, they would call it an intransitive verb. It means it don't move. A transient is someone who moves around. A transitive verb means it's an action verb. So a verb shows action or state of being, shows being. State of being. Since this is a noun, but it has verbal character, it is a verbal noun. Nouns don't act. They don't show action in their very definition. Outside the sentence, if we put down baptized, I say, what is that? That's a verb. But if you put it into a sentence where it's used as a noun, what he's saying, here's what I'm trying to say to you. When he says, he commanded them, and it doesn't even say in the Greek, it doesn't say to be baptized, he commanded them, B-B-A-P-I-S, Baptis, T-H, Ada, N-A, Yoda. That's the word, to be baptized. To be is not there. Ada, N-A-I, the word E-I-M-A-I is the word to be. So what they do is they incorporate on the ending of the word, to be. But in the Greek, to be, if I said to be baptized, you're thinking of dipping somebody in water, aren't you? But wait a minute. It's a noun. It is verbal, I understand. But being a noun, it doesn't show action on the part of the subject. The action is taken on the subject. Whoops. The action is taken on the noun. If baptized was dipping in water, this could not be an infinitive. Now you understand that. I know you do. Everybody else might not understand. There's no possible way that it could be a noun. But it's like saying, he commanded them to be, to exist as the covered. Now, the word command is a word in the Greek. It means a lawful injunction. An injunction is a legal term from a court that is a command. It's a lawful injunction. And not only that, but the infinitives in the Greek have tense. It sounds like to be baptized would be something that they're going to do, doesn't it? But that noun has got, that verbal noun has got tense in its aorist. Aorist is past tense. What it is a legal injunction. You are covered. Continue in your covering. He's not telling them to go be dipped in water. That's not what he's saying. First of all, he couldn't say be dipped because that is not the word. That's a noun. You see what I'm saying? I know Jeanette understands this better than anybody in here, because she teaches and it's easy for her to pick it up that quick. You understand that, don't you? That's why it's so important to define these words. You can't have a noun showing action or a movement into on the part of the subject. It shows a movement of the fluid only. Where does that fluid come from? It comes from an outside source. It's called the blood of Christ. You have been washed. Continue in your washing. And you see the word in, E-N? Just let me give you about, Let me just give you something about aorist tense. Aorist is past tense. Now, I'm going to try to keep them getting complex. You've got different kinds of aorist tense. You've got constative. Now, when I say constative, just think of something that's constant, okay? Something that just continues. You've got constative. Now, most people, he talks about an abused aorist. This is Daniel Wallace, Greek Grammar Beyond the Basics. He talks about, he says there's an abused aorist. That's when men will say, the aorist means once for all in the past. That's it. It's done. I like what he says here. This is, you have a constative aorist, which means to iterate in nature. When we say iterate, we mean to repeat over and over, don't we? Now, if you take the aorist just by itself, a past tense verb, you'll say it's past, it's already happened. Yes, but he's saying, you've been washed in the blood, continue in the same washing that you've been in. Because the aorist is iterative in nature. The constitutive aorist is iterative, and it means it can mean over and over, or a duration of time, or constant or continual. Then you have a consummative. Just think of consummate. Finality, that means momentary. But he says the way you can tell whether it's just an event that happened in the past or it's something continual. Let me read just a line to you, and let me read it slow so you'll understand. He said whether it's a constative or an ingressive, if I say ingressive, you say, Jim, that's too hard to understand. Now, you guys at Hunt, you know what an egress is, don't you? Huh? That means get off my land, posted, right? An egress is a way to get out. An ingress means an entering into. An ingressive aorist means to move into or entrance into a state, and it can be constant the same way as a constative is. Let me write that down. Constative, C-O-N-S-T-A-T-I-V-E. Constative means a constant. Ingressive means to move into action, and these are both forms of aorist tense. Gosh, this is more complex than English, isn't it? This is just, we're not even started. And what are we going to do? Throw all this away? Does it not mean anything? But these preachers are not going to tell you about this because they don't care. The fact that that word baptized is a noun, and it can't show movement on the part of the person. A movement has to be taken on them, and besides that, it has already begun because it's aorist. Is that important, Jeanette? Yes. Ask an English teacher, she'll tell you. Is it important? It's everything. That means you can't just be dipped in water. He said you've been washed in the blood of Christ. Continue in it. And the way you can tell, I love what he says here. This just tickles me dead. I think Jeanette, I just have to use this one as an illustration. She'll understand this real well. The way you can tell whether it's just a momentary or a consummative, I put ingressive, constative, ingressive. These are, sometimes the best scholars have a hard time telling the difference in these. Then you have the consummative, consummate, to finish, to finalize the past tense. C-O-N-S-U-M. Is there two M's? Yeah, M. Consummative aorist, that means it happens once for all, boom, it's done. That's like if I said, the way you can tell, let me read this and then I'll tell you this. The way you can tell whether it's a movement of the past tense, I'll just call it past tense instead of aorist. whether it's constative or ingressive, which both of those can mean over and over continual, and whether it's a consummative, to consume or finalize, or it's just a one-time happening in the past. He said, the way you can tell, this is more due to the lexical intrusion. Gosh, Jim, I don't understand lexical. Do you know dictionary? A lexicon is a dictionary. A lexicon is an isolated, it is isolated items of a vocabulary. It's a stock of words in their order. It means just to formulate sentences that you get out of a dictionary. That's what it means. An intrusion means to force one's way into. He says that the lexical intrusion will determine, rather than the grammatical force of the tense. It will be more than whether it's past tense. It will be what this lexical context of words says, as much as the tense of the verb. He says that'll tell you. You say, what do you mean, Jim? If I said he died, that's consummative, isn't it? The guy down the street died. It was one time in the past, wasn't it? What if I said he died spiritually? Uh-oh. How often do we die? Paul said, I die daily. That'd either be ingressive or constative. It wouldn't be finalized, because we have to die every day, don't we? Do you understand that? I know that's hard, Larry, but what I'm trying to say is the aorist is just past tense. It's something happened in the past. When Peter commanded them, he used a legal term. He said, be baptized. You've already been baptized in blood. You continue in this continually. He's not telling them to go be dipped in water. And when he says, can any forbid, he says to forbid, and that word forbid means to prevent. Can any prevent the water? Can any to prevent? It is a verbal noun also. Can any build a dam up and stop the water on these Gentile proselyte converts? Can we stop doing that? Because they don't need that. It was Peter said that, let's stop the water, let's stop the circumcision. Well, he said, let's stop the circumcision, didn't he, over in the 15th chapter. Go over to the 15th chapter. Oh, by the way, when Peter says be baptized in the name, he uses the verb, he uses the little article, en. And when that's used with an infinitive, when this is used with an infinitive, be baptized, en, not be baptized, EIS, like there in the 28th chapter of Matthew. Not be baptized, EPI, in Acts 2.38. Acts 2.38 says be baptized, epi, superimposing, covering with the name. Well, what does the word name mean? The word name is onoma. O-N-O. I'm running out of space. The word name is onoma. The word name is onoma. Onoma means authority. That means God's character. Be baptized. This word en, when it's used with an infinitive, means with or by. It does not mean into. It means be baptized with the authority of Christ. You've been baptized with His authority. God's authority is His word. It's His truth. You've been baptized. Continue in it. They didn't talk like we talk. You know what's wrong with America? We got all these English Bibles and none of us understand what these original things meant. Jim, I can't understand Greek. If you come here, how long does it take you to start waking up in your sleep saying these things?
Not long.
Glenn called one day and he said, got up one morning and said, Jim, what's doulagogil? It's been going through my head all night. I said, bring your body into subjection there, Glenn. Last verse of the 9th chapter of 1 Corinthians means to force oneself to obey. You say, this is the Holy Word of God. The King James Bible is not the Holy Word of God. The Textus Receptus is the Holy Word of God. The original text. I use a King James. Why do I use a King James? Because I got all these. I got a library upstairs. I've got all these books. I've got books numerically coded to the Strong's numbering system. And the Strong's is, and even Mr. Strong gets a lot of the words wrong. You can't trust one man. And I brought that out, how he took a, there in Hebrews, the 3rd chapter, the 11th verse, he took a, the word taste, tau eta sigma, which is the word the, feminine gender, and translated over into the masculine gender, my, in the English, referring to God. Does that matter? Yes, that's what's wrong with us. Well, why's God got a Bible for us like that? Well, because we're living in the last days, and he's going to confuse our languages one more time, and that causes the apostasy. That's what's wrong. We don't have any proper translations, but if you'll come here after 6 months, you'll be saying, I've had people come here. We got housewives come here, and people say, well, I can't learn that Greek like you know. Bill, are you a scholar? Wherever you are.
Huh?
Learner, yeah. He's a scholar. He's a learner. Bill learns these words. Brooks can spew it off about 100 miles an hour. Brooks knows probably most everything except this constitutive and ingressive aorist that I've said here this morning. Because I'm going to say these things over and over and over and over. I'm going to be a good teacher. I'm going to repeat it over and over and over till it's coming out your ears. It's not hard if I said confess. If somebody up the street, this devil's broadcasting network, says confess, they mean say with the lips. No, Jesus said this people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. The word confess, H-O-M-O, you recognize that, homo. A homosexual means of the same sex. Homo, L-O-G-E-O, homo of the same logos, word. Logos is the word. But they said anyone who confessed would obey. That's not what we mean when we say confess, is it? We mean, I love Jesus. See, watch my lips. See, J-E-S-U-S. I can spell it. Jesus, I'm going to heaven. That ain't it.
Means to agree.
Huh? Means to agree with.
Jesus talked about two baptisms in Luke, too.
Yeah.
Remember that he didn't break the Levitical law?
Yeah.
Spiritually baptized in 322 and then drinking the cup in 1250. Remember that? Show them that.
Yes, I remember that. I quoted 1250 a while ago. Now, see, Glenn can come out here and preach if you want to, and Brooks can come up here and preach. And they can just spew out. I mean, Brooks, you want to come up here and write some words on the board? You think these people can't do that? I can go over here, and Greg can start writing words. We can bring him over here in his wheelchair, and he needs to get up there and start writing. And Marcella can write these words, can't she? And Andy can write words on the board, and Tracy can write. These boys in here in this nursery can write these Greek words on the board and tell you what they mean. They go around here talking about Greek words. And you say, why is that important? That's because we don't have the correct words. That's what's wrong. Where was I? I was going somewhere. And I, huh? Acts 15. Yeah, I want to show you this. Peter said, let's prevent, let's dam up the water to the Gentiles. Remember the proselyte baptism? Proselyte baptism, they had to be circumcised and washed in water. Peter said, let's stop the water right here. He doesn't say, can any forbid water that you should not be baptized? What about the Ethiopian eunuch? Oops. What we're going to do? I messed up. You remember when Philip baptized the Ethiopian eunuch? You remember that? And they went down in the water. Philip did not tell the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts 8, in verse 37. Philip said, here's water, what doth hinder me to be baptized? What nationality was the Ethiopian eunuch? Ethiopian eunuch. He was an Ethiopian. He wasn't a Hebrew. He was a Gentile. He had heard, and everyone had heard about proselyte baptism. Everyone in the world knew about it. No one in the world was worshiping Jehovah God but Israel, and they were a thorn to the Romans. And they were just a little province of the two southern tribes. Northern Israel wasn't back during the time of Jesus. And the Ethiopian eunuch knew about baptism, and Philip did not tell him he had to be baptized in water, did he? He said, can I be baptized in water and be identified with Israel? And you know what Philip said to him? He said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. Now, the word mayest is E-Z-E. Z is S-T-I-N. He said, it's permitted. That's what he said. It's lawful if you want to. That's up to you. You're permitted to do it. He did not say, I'm commanding you to do it. He said, it's just permissible if that's what you want to be identified as a member of the kingdom of God or Israel. That's what he said. He did not have to be washed in water. You say, then why did they? Let me just show you this and I'll stop here. Let's go to 15. Paul was coming back from his missionary journey. In chapter 15, some men were following him. He was coming back from all of this Gentile land over here. He was coming back from Galatia. And as he's coming back, he's got some of these guys following him. Say, you got to go back and circumcise these Gentiles. They're going to come to Israel. You got to circumcise them. Peter had already said in the 10th chapter, let's quit washing them in water. And then it was Peter here that says, down here in verse 7, and when there had been much disputing, they were at the council in Jerusalem. Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, you know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth in Acts 10 should hear the good word of the gospel and believe. And I've said, let's quit washing them in water. Now let's cease this circumcision stuff. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ we shall be saved, even as they, not by circumcision. He said, let's stop the circumcision on the Gentiles and let's stop the water. That's what they were doing. Look, here's how it stopped. Colossians 2, and I'll stop right here. Colossians 2. I'll read this and I'll quit. And I'm going to come back and teach more on this next week. I hope you can see why it's important to understand that baptized was a noun. It was verbal in Acts 10:48. Because a noun doesn't show action. The action had to be taken upon it. God flows the blood of Christ out across a world. And those on whom it takes, you're just like a Polaroid camera. You're the elect of God. You're the predestinated elect. And on the vessels of wrath that are fitted for destruction, it flows on by. It don't stick on you. It sticks on the elect. Because they've got ears to hear. And he says here, look here, in verse 11, speaking of Christ, in whom you are circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. He's talking about a circumcision that is spiritual. Then he talks about baptism in the next verse. And he's writing to Colossia. That is a Gentile church over here on the southwestern end of what we call Turkey. They called Asia Minor. These were Gentiles. He's talking about circumcision, baptism, isn't he? He's not talking about literal circumcision. He says a spiritual circumcision, and this baptism is spiritual. Buried with him in baptism? How's he buried? In a cave? He's talking about a spiritual burial. He's not talking about putting 6 feet under. Buried with him in baptism, wherein you are risen with him, through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead, and we die daily in resurrection. Anastasis means to come to life after dying. And how often do we die? Every day we carry our cross daily. That's a baptism. And you being dead in your sins, in the uncircumcision of your flesh, Colossia, you Corinthian, you Colossian church, hath he quickened together with him, made you alive, having forgiven you all trespasses, and blotting out the handwriting of ordinances. He blotted out all the rituals, the literal circumcision, the literal baptism, all the rituals of the Old Testament, which were contrary to us, took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. When they wanted to do away with the contract, some of the writers said they don't believe that they had such a law. I believe it because it's found right there. Some of the writers say that they would take the document, the original contract, if they were going to invalidate it, they'd take the two witnesses and the two parties who originally agreed to it, they'd take it out in public, drive a nail through it, and invalidate the old contract. When Jesus was nailed to the cross, all the ordinances were blotted out. Now everything is spiritual that was once literal. That's what he's talking about. I don't believe in being dipped in water. I was dipped about 8 times. It didn't do me any good. Just got me soaked, that's all. And I did get unbaptized in the water. So whenever that's blotted out, God took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. I'm going to come back next week. And that's why he says, don't let any man judge you in these Jewish feasts or holy days or new moons or Sabbaths. I'm going to come back next week. I'm going to continue this. I'm not ever going to finish this. I didn't get to finish this up here. Somebody's going to have to give me a copy of this so I can finish it. The word reconciled. Let me just read this. A demon was a deity. The demon started in the garden. Little G-O-D, theos, Elohim, means a judge. God said, thou shalt not, and Eve said, I'll be the judge of that. She became her own God. They had to be reconciled to God by death, a covering of baptism. The first covering baptism of blood is found in Genesis 3:21. That's where God killed an animal and he had to kill a lamb. He must have killed a lamb and he clothed Adam and Eve because of their sin. And he has to make us realize we're naked in need of a covering. Tree worship is demon worship. Eve looked at the tree. She saw all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. That's all that's in the world. She began to distribute fortunes. She saw a tree that was good for food, the lust of the flesh. She saw a tree that was pleasant to the eyes, the lust of the eyes. She saw a tree that would make her wise, the pride of life. Started in the garden, the first covering blood baptism. Daemon means distribute fortunes. That's what the tree worship is. That's the exact same meaning as capitalism. That's why America's so evil. I saw a lawyer friend of mine down here at Kroger's. I said, democracy and capitalism is evil. It lets us fulfill our flesh. You mean you think we ought to be communists? Like I said one time, we need a righteous king to rule us. One lady said, where are we going to get a righteous king? Jesus coming back. Man can't come up with any system that can rule. When God speaks to those who have ears to hear, Adam heard God. He was definitely the son of God. Some people say, maybe Adam wasn't saved. He was a son of God. And he heard God. He causes them to realize that they have need of a covering. And Adam said, I'm naked. And that's a baptism. They repent because they're children that hear. Then he covers them, baptizes them with blood. That's God doing the covering. Didn't he cover them? And he has to cover us. And that's why the infinitive, it's important to know that. Then they begin to agonize. And that's what, isn't that what he said? Now you're going to have to earn your living by sweat of your brow. Isn't that it? The very picture of everything is in the third chapter of Genesis. The gods or the demons, our ancestors, Adam and Eve, that possess us, or rather, we possess them in this lust of the flesh, in this cursed gift which we receive from him, we receive from Adam and Eve, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. These three wishes of the genie, Genos, this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. That means kin folks, the word kind when they cast out demons. It means kindred. And the only kindred we have, the Arabs called them genies and the Jews called them demons. And you get three wishes from the genie, don't you? And the word wish is the word Venus in the Latin. You get three wishes: the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. That's all that's in the world when you start distributing fortunes. If you believe in demons, you have to believe in genies and vampires. I'm sorry. You got to believe that Barbara Eden is real. And that Count Dracula is real. You have to believe that. Maybe he's not from Transylvania. Maybe he's from Pennsylvania. These three wishes of the genie. I've gone through that many times. Go out by prayer and fasting. I'm going to go through that next week. Matthew 17. True fasting is found in Isaiah 58. The fast is to afflict the soul or humble self. A true covering is a blood baptism. It's painful. A false covering is a lie. Lanthano means to lie hid. Alanthano, placing the alpha privity in front of lanthano, means to not to lie high anything. That's the word truth. That's preached by the pseudo-prophet, taste the false prophets. It's an easy gospel. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word and truth. God, help us to understand this, Lord. We must understand, as your believers, that we have to die and follow you daily. Teach us that we have to be baptized in a blood baptism, a death to this old flesh. That's why Jesus died for us, so he can cover us with his blood. And our robes are made white in his blood. That's the covering we need, Father, if we're going to be the wife, the bride of Christ. Thank you for your truth, and we'll give you praise for all things. In Christ's name, amen.